Hey everybody, it's Tony Trombo. Today's show is brought to you by Audible.com. Now you can get a free audiobook. That is a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo. They have over 150,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. That's audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo.
Hi, this is Candy Zappa. I'm Frank Zappa's little sister.
Hi, this is Bob Harris, former Frank Zappa band member.
Hi, folks. This is Robert Bobby Martin from Frank Zappa's band, 81 through 88.
Hi, grown-up boys and girls. I'm Sandro Liva, and I was the Italian of the group with the Grandmothers in the 90s.
Hi, this is Arthur Barrow, a.k.a. the Clone Meister for the Frank Zappa Band, as well as his bass player.
Hey, this is Lisa Popeil.
Hi, this is Susanna Harris, former vocalist for Frank Zappa.
This is Billy Hulping from Zappa Plays Zappa.
This is Ike Willis, and we're talking Zappa on Uncle Tony's station here. Please, everybody listen. I had a great time, and so will you.
Hi, boys and girls. This is Don Preston. You're listening to Talking Zappa, and you should all listen to this show because it's fantastic.
Fantastic. Hey, everybody. It's Tony with Talking Zappa. How's everybody doing tonight? You know, these are all my shows, all my tons and tons of shows put up here on YouTube so you can find them. Finally, you can go to one place and get them all. I had them spread out all over the place because I was using different platforms, different ways to record them, phone, Skype. Oh, man, it was just a giant mixture of things that I was trying. So now they're all being put up here on YouTube for you to find and share. You know, hit that share button and tell all your friends. And that helps me. Thank you. Also, you subscribe to this channel because that way when I put up new ones, which is all the time, and do new ones, you'll be able to read about them and decide if you want to listen. Of course you want to listen. Why wouldn't you? Also, TonyTrombo.com, TonyTrombo is where you can follow me. Give me suggestions on people that I should try and interview. I've been getting quite a few, and it's amazing. People that I would never think of, never, you know, have met or heard of or whatever, that have done all kinds of Zappa-related stuff that I like talking to, and it's very interesting. Speaking of that, tonight, you know, this is an interview I did a little while back with a PR guy, somebody who promotes things with music and has worked with a lot of Frank's guys, and this is Billy James, and he's out of Asheville, North Carolina. And his job is just take, listen, I've got a record, Billy, and I need you to make me famous. And he just knows how to do it. He can promote with, you know, the different ways to promote things, radios and magazines, whatever. And so he's worked with a lot of them. This was very interesting to me, and I think you'll find it interesting too, as well. So here you go. Here's my interview with Billy James.
Hey, Billy, are you there?
Yeah. Hey, Tony. How are you?
Pretty good. Pretty good. Now I'm out of Nashville, as everybody knows. Where are you out of?
I'm not too far away. I'm in Asheville, North Carolina.
Oh, I could drive over there. Yeah, great.
Right. Not too far, actually. Maybe that's why the phone reception's so good.
Right.
Well, maybe. I don't know, but I'm up in the mountains, so I don't know.
Wow. Cool. Yeah, that's nice over that way. I love it over there. We don't get that way much, but. Great part of the world. Let's start off with, I know this is Talking Zappa, but you know what, I'm going to, you have a PR firm, and I've seen your client list, which is just humongous. What all right. Do you do for people, just so people know?
Well, first off, one of the reasons why, actually, that I started the PR firm was that many years ago when I started doing some recordings with the original Mothers, which was mainly Don Preston and Bunk Gardner, and we're talking in the early 90s, 1990 or whatever, I had found that, interestingly enough, that a lot of fans and people out there didn't even know that they were still making music. I remember getting a response, it must have been in the mail or something, saying, "Huh, Don Preston, I didn't know he was still alive." And I felt at that point, something needs to be done. And not only that, I mean, I also, at that point, was working with Michael Bruce and Neil Smith of the original Alice Cooper group, and it was the same sort of thing. I just found that, you know, a lot of these artists and a lot of these bands that are on my roster are my heroes, you know, my musical right. heroes, the reason why I got into music, particularly John Anderson of Yes, who's my top client.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm also doing some singing for him as well. But, you know, next to Zappa, Yes is one of my favorite bands. And so having him as my one of my top clients is a dream come true. But anyway, as far as publicity, what I do is I get these music artists, you know, in magazines and newspapers and on websites and blogs. I get them reviews and interviews and airplay, and then sometimes on TV. And it just depends on what, you know, the caliber of the artist, you know what type of press I can get them.
Right.
And anywhere from, as a matter of fact, I just finished doing a press campaign for a release by William Shatner, of all people.
Nice.
Captain Kirk, you know, which actually had George Duke was on it, which is his final keyboard solo, parts that he did was on this record. Steve I was on it. Zoothorn Rollo, who is a friend of mine, Bill Harkle wrote, and I actually wrote a book with him as well. He was on it, and so I can get press up to anywhere from Rolling Stone and magazines like that all the way to small blogs and all over the world, and that's what I do for these artists. And again, a lot of them are my personal heroes. I actually just going to be starting to do press for Mike Pinder, the original keyboard player from the Moody Blues,
right.
And Bill Nelson of Bebop Deluxe, who is a huge hero of mine as well. I'm going to be doing some press for one of his older catalog releases through a company in England. So, you know, it's that's what I do for
well,
that.
You know, it's really amazing that nobody thinks about your part in all this. You just think that somebody big puts out a record and all the, you know, all the magazines come running and everybody, you know, just comes after them. But it's kind of the opposite where you're going after it. And so nobody... You know, I wouldn't have even thought that there was that much into promoting somebody that's just huge anyways, but everybody needs that PR person.
Yeah, well, in certain respects. I mean, for instance, when John Anderson, if he has a new album, yeah, there's going to be, you know, a certain amount of people or press or radio that's going to come directly to me, but how are they going to know first? So, you know, you have to release the information. So that's the first thing, because you can't really always depend on the label having the stretch that a publicist would. So that's one thing, is getting the information out that a release is out there. But, for instance, John has a company out of California called Audio Fidelity is re-releasing John Anderson's very first solo record called Elias with Sun Hilla, which is a fantastic record from 1976. They're releasing it on a hybrid SACD. And so which is, you know, great news, but I had, I went ahead and issued a press release on behalf of John to the world to let them know the things coming out there. So that's one thing. You have to let the information out. But secondary, then you have a ton of people coming back wanting to interview the artist. And typically the artist doesn't sit there and field these, interview requests. They have to have somebody that fields them and sets them up and does all that stuff, you know, and keeps it in order. And, you know, and so that's what a publicist does as well. You know, and I do that for, you know, interview setting up, as you know, and keeping them scheduled. That's a big part of the deal. You know?
Now, you said you started working with Don and Bunk in the early 90s. How do you meet up with those guys? Do they come to you looking for PR work, or did you meet them in some other fashion?
Well, as far as Bunk and Don, well, originally, let's see how it all goes down here. And I'll tell you how my relationship with Frank Zappa, because I did a few rhythm charts years ago that Frank evidently utilized in his work or whatever, and I'll tell you about that as well, just a couple things.
Mm-hmm.
Because my very first album that I ever did, now again, I record music as well. I'm a drummer and percussionist, but I also do singing and arranging and producing and all that, and I have an act called Ant B, ANT-BEE, and my first record came out on the Vox record label out of Los Angeles in 1990. So it was like 30 years ago, I guess it was. And I just released a new record a couple years ago, which actually Bunk and Don and Buzz and Jimmy Carl Black and who else is on it? Napoleon Murphy Brock does an amazing lead vocal on a track. And that just recently came out. But But anyway, as far as Bunk and Don, the way I had met up with them, I was working on my second record, and I was actually I had a filmmaker, a guy named Fred Goss, who actually went on to produced a couple of TV shows. But at the time, he was filming a video for my act, Ampy, out in Los Angeles, and he handed me a card that said Bunk and Don, Music for All Occasions.
Nice.
You know, and as soon as I saw that, now again, I've been a Zappa fanatic since 1972 when I was 12 years old.
Right.
You know, so, I mean, and I'm 53 now, you know, so I've been into Frank, you know, almost all my life, you know, mm-hmm. And I've had the opportunity to meet him several times, and I went to Frank's house and laid on his floor and listened to music. You know, I have a lot of experiences there. But
I guess.
At any rate, I get handed this card. It says Bunk and Don, and I knew immediately, you know, Bunk. I mean,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I don't know anybody else named Bunk than Bunk Gardner. So I immediately called Bunk. I guess it was the first one. It may have been Don. I can't remember. But they were both very receptive to recording with me, and they came out to a studio and recorded a bunch of stuff, and it was just fantastic and a dream come true for me, being an old Mothers fan. And then they set me up with Jimmy Carl Black, and from them they set me up with, you know, Motorhead and Roy and Ray and everybody in the band, you know, and from then, and I've carried on a relationship as far as, you know, almost like they're uncles to me,
right.
Bunk and Don. I've been, as a matter of fact, Don and the grandmothers just played here. I promoted the show. They played here in May, and I brought my son to the show, and fantastic thing, you know, show, and it was great to see Don, you know, I mean, and he's 80-something years old, and he's still cooking. I mean, he's amazing.
Sure.
Incredible.
I saw him
you
here
ever have
in
a
Nashville.
Chance to go out and see? Oh, you saw him, yeah. What about the egg trick? Did he do the egg trick?
No. No.
Well, he does this thing. Well, I don't know if I should say it, because then it'll spoil the
yeah, right.
The
well, maybe
coming out. Now I'm not going to. I won't ruin it then. But he does this amazing egg trick. That's all I can say. And it's hilarious, too, you know. But the show was tight and incredible, and every one of the guys, and the drummer, Chris Garcia, who plays drums with him, he's fantastic as well. He's a good player. And so anyway, but I know they're going to be going back out. But so that's how I linked up with them. And, you know, from then it's been a very long and fruitful relationship. And I've done press for those guys for years. And we actually wrote a book together called Necessity Is. It was released in England, and it was wrote with mainly Bunk Don and Jimmy Carl Black, and did very well. Unfortunately, the publisher was a complete ripoff. And so the book is out of print right now, but it's a cool book if you ever find it, because it's really, you know, about the Mothers of Invention from the mother's point of view, you know, the original
right.
member's point of view. And anyway, but that's how I linked up with them. But I actually had, like I said, the very first record I ever recorded on was back in 1983 on Steve Vai's Flexible record.
Really?
So that's the long time. Yeah, and so that's how through him, I mean, I met Frank Zappa after a show, you know, in Atlanta in 1977, which was the, you know, the with Terry Bozzio and Adrian Belew, that band,
sure.
Sheik Your Booty Band, and I at the Fox Theater in Atlanta, and I stood outside, you know, I was, I think, 16 years old or 17, I stood outside and shook his hand, you know, that was the first time I ever met him. But the second time, you know, again, I had started working with Steve back in 1983. I think it was April 83. I moved and lived in his house and did some calligraphy for him, for some charts, and I did some drum stuff for him. And then Steve would do. He's an amazing transcriber, probably the most incredible transcriber you ever.
Yeah,
would
I
see.
Own some
he did
of his
book
stuff.
Yeah, the Zappa guitar book. If you ever saw the Zappa guitar book, and so if you know any of the transcriptions, there's some of the most incredible, difficult, rhythmic.
Mm-hmm.
you know what these transcriptions are live, you know, live jams or whatever, you know, live portions
right.
of shows.
Right.
You know, and Frank would have Steve take these live things, and then he would transcribe them, and then Frank on several occasions would then take the transcribed music and turn that into an arrangement. You know, he turned it just, you know, it was a live jam or whatever, a live free-form improvisation, but then he was able to turn it into a composition that way,
sure.
you know, and arrange it for horns or whatever. But inside, you know, when he transcribed this stuff, some of the rhythmic passages, these polyrhythms and subdivided polyrhythms and some of the most difficult rhythm passages you'll ever know, to the point where most musicians can't play them or comprehend them, if not 99.9%.
Sure.
And so what I did was I you know, again, I'm a Berkeley graduate, and I'm very bright on rhythm, and I took these passages, some of these scores, and I would go through them and take these rhythmic passages, and I devised a mathematical formula how to break up these very difficult rhythms, and how to play, to break them up mathematically to see how they work. Mathematically and how they play against each other. So a person, if Frank wanted to teach somebody in a band or something like that, you could actually look at it and count it off and look at it this way. Now, how much he used them, I sent Frank a few things, and I know, I understand he used a couple of them. I don't know how much. Steve did tell me that one time he was in Novi, he was over at Frank's house and was going through some... A cabinet or whatever, a filing cabinet. Mm-hmm. And there was all these old scores and things in there that Frank had written, one of his first drum pieces called Mice, I think it was, back in the 50s or something like that, a drum piece. And anyway, Steve told me that a couple of Steve's scores were in there, and then one of my pieces was in there. So that was a great honor to me, So at any rate, I had done some of that stuff, and one night, one day, Dweezil, and he was like 12 years old, we had been recording at Steve's home studio in Fillmore, California, and again, this is probably 1983, I'm going to say May 83, and we had been jamming all day. Dweezil came in, 12 years old, and he was evidently an Eddie Van Halen fanatic at the time. You could tell. I mean, I remember talking to him, and that's all I could say. Eddie Van Halen, he was just mad for him, and he played great for at the time. The only thing I remember that it was he had at the time, he was 12 years old, so it was just mainly soloing. So I remember, and I actually have a tape of me playing drums and Dweezil and Steve playing guitars, and it was complete madness sounding. But anyway. So we jammed all day long, and then we went to take him home that night up to the house. And, so Frank answers, Frank answered the door and had us come into the amazing house in the studio. And he had just gotten home with the London Symphony Orchestra tapes, that LSO release that he put out. These were the unedited tapes. And so we went up into the control room, and, he showed us, I guess he had just got his digital recording board and unit and everything, one of the first, I think, in L.A., a digital recording console. And we're in there, and I brought some charts and things of that nature and to show him. And so we were up there just for a few minutes, talking or whatever, and I do remember that, he goes, well, I want to play you guys the tape, so go on down into the studio part. And, are you still there?
Yep.
Okay, yeah, something sounded like I hung up there. Anyway, so just as we were, Steve goes, come on, Billy, let's go on down into the studio part to listen to the music. And it's just a very narrow stairwell there coming from the control room in Frank's home studio in Los Angeles. And there's all these tapes, reel-to-reel tapes at the time, stacked up, on the sides of the thing. And just as I was trying to go down the stairwell, Gail was coming up the stairwell, his wife.
Right.
And so I was trying to get around her, and I knocked over a stack of his tapes.
Uh-oh.
And I remember seeing Uncle Meat laying there, and I'm going, oh, man, my life went, my life flashed before my eyes right now.
Right, right.
Because he shot me a look like, what the,
Yeah.
And, so anyway, I'm like picking him up, and Gail's going, oh, that's okay, it happens all the time, but anyway, so we went down into the studio part, and it was immaculately clean. I do remember there was a photo of him and Ringo Starr from 200 Motels with Ringo dressed as Frank, and that was hung up on the wall there, a little photo is what I remember, and some regular chairs, stacking type seats, and beautiful carpet and just really immaculate studio section, the studio part. So I remember sitting down there and laying on the floor, me and Steve and my other friend and Mike, and we were sitting there listening to this incredible, incredible sounding. I mean, it was unbelievable, the LSO stuff, but coming from Frank Zappa's recording studio and the monitors, it was just like unbelievable. I've never heard anything so beautiful in my life. And I do remember he came down, and actually when I was looking up at the console part where he was still sitting, I could see that, you see he was sitting there checking out my charts that I sent him, and you could see cigarette smoke coming up from behind the charts, So anyway, he came down to the main room after that and sat down beside me, actually. We were all sitting there, and he looked at me and goes, well, what did you think? And I just said, well, I think I need to go home and practice.
You know?
And he broke up laughing, you know, and that felt great. I made Frank Zappa laugh, you know, and, you know, that's to me, that was fantastic, a fantastic feeling to be able to do that. And so the rest of the, you know, we talked for a little bit and went home. But it was an incredible evening, I have to say. That was my first real true interaction. But I had several other ones, interactions with Frank. You know, I don't have much time we have here. But that was an amazing thing right there.
Now, your book is actually, there's some copies of your book on Amazon, several used ones, some new ones, and they're asking quite a bit for it. But I put a link up on my website there just so if people wanted to actually go and buy it and read it. It sounds fascinating. Let people get it if they can.
They've been out of print for a while and they're hard to get. And, you know, to be honest, I don't know how much, you know, in relation to, you know, the Zappa family as far as putting it back out and everything, you know, I don't know.
Sure.
Because I never had any problems or anything said, but, you know, I don't know if
right.
I don't know if it's worth the headaches to try to put the thing back out there. And frankly, right now, I don't have a publisher to do that. You know,
right.
I mean, I do have one that I'm working with reissuing my other stuff, but I don't know if they want to mess with it as well, you know,
sure.
at the moment. And I don't blame them.
Let me ask
you. But it is a great book.
One question that I've always had, and you're going to know this. Speaking of the Steve Vai Flexible album, rumor had it that it was done on an 8-track reel-to-reel at home. Was that true, or is that just nonsense?
No, it was. Yeah.
Really?
8-track reel-to-reel.
I mean, if you listen to that thing, it sounds like. And okay, people argue, well, look, the Beatles and their 4-track. Okay, cool, but still. Listen to that Flexible album.
Not a million, a lot of it are, you know, he had the basic tracks laid, but other than the guitar overdubs, there's not really a lot of overdubs other than that. He does a lot of guitar overdubs.
Right.
But listening to it, it's very, granted, I haven't heard any of his other albums, but to me, his, that record is very, a lot of it's very basic sounding as far as, you know, recording-wise, but...
Right.
There are sections that he recorded a zillion guitars and overdubbed a lot of stuff, you know, at the time. And just an interjection about my piece on that record is that originally, now there, what's on there right now is, a 40-second piece called Bill's Private Parts, which is a percussion piece. That's not originally what was recorded and what it was called. Originally, when I first got to L.A. in 1983, and I moved in to live with Steve for, I forgot how many months, maybe 3, 4 to 5 months, and lived on his floor, that the first thing I did for him, and I believe it was the very first night I got into L.A., he handed me this thing called Pilot Light, which was a percussion chart, very difficult percussion chart for several different drums. And I learned it, and we recorded it, and it came out quite good, I thought, you know, and it was almost like a 2.5-minute piece, almost 3 minutes. It was a long percussion piece.
Mm-hmm.
And for whatever reason, and then I had recorded actually some other piece that never came out on the record. It never came out on anything else. It was taken off at the last moment because Pilot Light wasn't supposed to go on anything for that. I think it was just something he was doing. But for his record, the Flexible record, we had recorded, it was me and Bob Harris and Susanna Harris and Steve, and maybe Stu Hamm on bass, and it was called Should I Care? And it was a very straight-ahead rock, kind of a rock type of song, I don't know, it was just a rock ballad, I guess it was, and very cool song, it was completely done, and for whatever reason, he decided not to use it on the record, and then he took this Pilot Light thing and took a section of it. I know he turned something backwards on it, like the cowbell on one small second worth of something, and released it like that, and called it Bill's Private Parts for whatever reason. I have no idea. But that's that, you know. I mean, that's the history of that song. But it's not the original song, and somewhere in his... collection, the original versions there. I did some other thing called Incredible Sucking Cheese, S-U-C-K-I-N-G, cheese.
Right.
But that's never seen the light of day or anything as well. I mean, I have all these tapes in my collection, but, Yeah, and that's what I did. And actually, through him, that's how I met Bob Harris, who, to this day, him and Susanna are very dear friends of mine. And I'll have to say, Bob is one of the greatest vocalists you'll ever see. I mean, you see Michael Bublé out there. Bob could sing circles around him. Incredible singer.
They sent me some of their CDs and things like that. And, yeah, it's just, in fact, some of the stuff that he does, you could tell, when you listen to a CD and you know that somebody can really do, like, a lot, like, they, you know, the Journey guys heard Steve Perry and said, okay, you're going to tear up on this. You're going to put all the hardest stuff ever, and it sounds great. And I always hear things that Bob does, and I think, you know, he's just hitting those high notes and things like that, but I always wonder, you know, can you go higher than that, you know, because I've heard him on those Zap albums, and just like, you know, I know, Bob, that you can break glass if you really tried to, so.
Well, he could if he wanted to, and I mean, I saw him a few years, the Axe came through here, and so
yeah,
we got together, and it was really nice to see him again after all these years, but I actually, you know, I saw Bob before I met him. I was invited to, actually, through Steve. I met up with Steve it was Rhode Island, 1981. I don't remember I think it was November 81. And I think Frank was playing at the Rhode Island Civic Center or something. And so I got went and saw the show. I got backstage and spoke with Frank for a minute. And, but I didn't meet Bob, but Bob was playing in that band. It was Vinny Colaiuta on drums, which he was incredible, you know, Ike and Ray, I believe. And, may not have been Ray, though. It may have just been Ike and Steve. And so incredible show. And anyway, but so I didn't meet Bob that night, but once moved to L.A. in 83, and I was in Steve's studio one day, and Bob came in, and he was doing the parts for Flexible. And that's what I met him, and I told him, hey, I saw you perform, and you were incredible. And we became fast friends, and through that, I recorded on Bob's solo record, The Great Nostalgia. I did all the percussion.
Which I have right here in my, I got it right here.
And then Bob's on my records, him and Susanna, you know.
Sure.
Yeah, that's a great album. Have you listened to it yet?
Oh, yeah, I listened to the whole thing. It's in my car.
Beautiful, beautiful record. It's like, you know, it's like a Brian Eno record in its own way. Very ambient and beautiful, beautiful music, and his singing is fantastic, and I've been very close with him and Susanna ever since, you know, and that all came from meeting him that one day in the studio over at Steve's.
Well, I've got about 4 minutes. I got to get to just a couple. I noticed, and this is the thing, Alice Cooper and Frank Zappa, just like all the time together. I mean, I kind of know the story between those two, but they're really connected a lot more than what people know, I think.
Well, here's real quickly, and if you ever get a chance, there's a new documentary DVD out called From Straight to Bizarre, which is about Frank's labels from the late 60s, the Straight and Bizarre records.
Yes, right.
The connection through Alice Cooper and Frank Zappa was that Frank signed the Alice Cooper group to their first record deal.
Yeah.
And that's the connection, you know. And whether Alice and Frank were tight friends, I don't know about that, and I don't think that's true. I know Alice in the band, and I'm very close with Michael Bruce. Me and him have been recording and done stuff for many years. And again, I rep him and Neil Smith, but as far as publicity wise. But I know that all those guys highly respected Frank and all that. And again, Frank signed the group, but were they friends and did they hang out? No, not at all. I don't think so at all. But that's the connection. That's really the connection.
That's it.
Is because Frank got them signed to the Straight label. And actually, after two records, they went on to, Warner Brothers and left the label. And I think that's probably the last time he probably ever talked to Frank was then.
Yeah.
You know, but Alice, to his benefit, always said good things about Frank. Same with Grand Funk, who's, I've done a book with Don and Mel of Grand Funk, which is another thing. And always good things about Frank, you know, that's the thing. That's the only connection I know of, about Alice and Frank.
Well, you know,
get
what?
That documentary. It's a great DVD.
I've got that documentary on my list here of things to watch. I just haven't got a chance to do it. But that, now that you talk about it, I'm going to go and watch that later on tonight because that seems.
Yeah,
that seems really interesting. You know, I'm looking at just people that you work with, and I'm just so running out of time with Steve Morris and Raymond Zarek and Adrian Ballou, Pat Travers. I mean, wow, these are some these are some big, you know, because I'm 53 myself, and I've, you know, grown up with all these people, too, and it's just like, that's
well, I've worked with all my heroes.
Yeah, well, I mean.
Although, as far as Pat Travers, that was an album that I was doing, a label that I was doing press for, so I didn't work directly with him. 99% of, you know, I'd say 95% of those artists I rep currently, or I have repped. Some of them come, like Ray Manzarek, you know, I worked his very final record, him and Roy Rogers, but that wasn't through him because he died or passed away, unfortunately.
Right.
So it was never directly with him, but it was through his label. And that's, you know, some of them are through labels and stuff.
Sure,
but
right.
A lot of them, like John Anderson and Greg Lake and, you know, Steve Morris, a lot of those people I did directly, you know, that's the thing as well.
There we go. My interview with Billy James. Interesting, huh? I need to work with somebody like that to make me famous, rich and famous, or rich or famous. I'll take the rich part. So please subscribe to this YouTube channel if you like it, and I got all kinds of Zappa stuff and all kinds of other things too. Share it with your friends. Give the old thumbs up there, the little blue thumbs up button. That helps too. And TonyTrombo.com, TonyTrombo, and if you have somebody you want me to try and get a hold of, let me know, and I will try. And so, that's it. I'll see everybody next time on the world-famous Talking Zappa. Hey, everybody, it's Tony Trombo. Today's show is brought to you by Audible.com. Now, you can get a free audiobook. That is a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo. They have over 150,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. That's audibletrial.com/Tony Trombo.
Good night, Austin, Texas, wherever you are.